Good morning and welcome to Emmanuel High Church. I'm so happy that you've joined us in spirit from wherever you are this morning for a time of worship. I'd like to give a special welcome to anyone who might be joining us for the first time today, and a special thank you to Greg Foster for being our liturgist. Today is Sunday, September 13th, the 15th Sunday after Pentecost, and our 26th Sunday of worshiping at home. Upcoming events, our Sunday school right after coffee hour today. So I invite all our kids to stay on for a special story and to have a chat with all of your Sunday school friends. Upcoming things are also movie night, September 25th. If you are missing high school football, this is your chance to get a little dose of high school football with the movie Remember the Titans. We will be bringing our own snacks. We were trying to get a food truck, but that did not happen. So bring your own snacks. And on that vein, I got a letter from the Empty Bowl Project folks. This year, because of the coronavirus, they are not having an Empty Bowl event, but they wanted us to know that they are still accepting food donations. Many folks already donated food, but they're still accepting it. There's going to be an event on Saturday, October 3rd from 8 to 12. Volunteers will be there to get bags of or boxes of food. But they wanted to let you know, if you can't make it at this time, there's a secure drop box just outside the food cupboard building, which is checked every day. And of course, they still gratefully accept checks. Our pet blessing is still on. And so whether you have a pet or not, if you would like to come out and be with us, we will be meeting out of doors at the lower pavilion at Doylestown Memorial Park, like we always meet. So I invite you and your pet, or without a pet, or with a picture of a pet, however you'd like to come and celebrate with us that day. Bring a mask, just for you, not your pets, and join us in the pavilion. And then the following week, on October 4th, that Sunday, that's World Communion. And the elders have decided this year we're going to do it in the parking lot. So we will have a parking lot worship. You can either stay in your car or bring chairs if it's nice out that day and sit in front of your car. Bring your own communion. If you don't have communion, we will be providing our communion pre-sealed cup and wafer, but if you prefer to bring your own, that's fine too. Also, we will be doing a Zoom book study entitled White Fragility. That's going to start on Wednesday evenings on October 7th, 6:30. It'll be via Zoom. I put a link on our Wednesday midweek message to Amazon for all different varieties of how to buy that book, whether you like it Kindle or hardback, a paperback, or Audible. You can order it there or get a used copy. Right now it's on back order with the library. There's a big waiting list. So I recommend, if you want to be in the book study, that you get your own copy. And it's also been recommended that we watch the documentary 13th, which refers to the 13th Amendment. I also put a link on our Wednesday message to that documentary. It is showing on Netflix for free, and it's also showing on YouTube for free. So if you don't have a copy of the Wednesday message, let me know and I will resend it to you. Let's see. Also, we're having a worship workshop sometime in October. I haven't gotten the exact date yet. If you're interested in joining a worship committee and coming to the worship workshop in October. It'll probably be on a Saturday or a Sunday afternoon. Let me know, and I will give you the information. If you are planning to be part of the book study with White Fragility, I do have a study guide. We will be doing 3 chapters a week. They're not particularly long chapters, so it won't be very arduous to do the reading. But I do have a reading guide that has questions that we'll be following on Wednesday nights. So if you're planning to be part of the group, let me know, and I will send you out a study guide that will help you as you go along. Starting this past week, I started being in the office on Thursdays. I'll be up in the balcony. Right now, both offices, mine and the secretary's office, are torn apart right now. They've been painted and we're waiting for new carpet. I'll be up in the balcony in the sanctuary. So if you'd like to talk to me, that's where you'll find me Thursday mornings. And finally, on Friday, there was some kind of hack of our phone list, and several people got a text saying it was from me, but it was not from me, asking for money in the form of gift cards. And I hope that no one followed up and paid that money, because it wasn't from me. If you did, let me know, but hopefully we got the word out in time. But if you get anything saying it's from the church, please check and make sure before giving any money over the internet or on the phone. Okay, I think that's it. Are there any other announcements? I'm looking at y'all for the good of the group. Okay, good. So as always, our microphones are muted to cut down on confusion, but I still ask you to participate by using your voice in your own home. You'll find someplace on your screen the chat box, and that's where you can type in any prayer requests you have. At lesson time, we'll be reading out of our own Bibles. So I hope you have your Bible so you can read along with us. And a candle to light in just a minute. Our scripture readings this morning are Psalm 114 and Exodus 14, verses 19 through 31. Our hymns this morning are Guide Me, O Great Jehovah, and Lead On, O King Eternal. After the service, you're welcome to grab a cup of coffee, and we'll unmute your mics and have coffee hour, and then move into Bible or to Sunday school with our kids. So now let's move into our time of worship by placing our right hand, as we do, on our hearts, and our left hand on our bellies, as we breathe in to the count of 4 and out to the count of more than 4. Breathing in the presence of God and breathing out, releasing any stress that we have. One more breath in, bringing in God's peace, and a breath out to release any leftover worry we might have. We remember this morning that no matter where we are, that God is with us, ever drawing us near to the spirit of oneness and love. If you have a candle, this is the time to take a moment to light it as I light the candles on our altar. The flame of the candle, we remember, represents the light of Christ and reminds us that Christ is the Holy Spirit, is always with us and within our hearts. And the candle also reminds us that regardless of what we were doing just moments ago. We've now entered into sacred time. We're not alone. Christ is here now and always within our hearts. Let's pray, shall we? As we gather, oh, this day, oh Lord, some in our own homes and some in places far away, we know that you too are seeking us. Help us to be attentive to your word and to feel your presence in our time of worship. Amen. Let's take a moment now to join in singing in our introit as we step into holy ground.
Please join me in the call to worship. Though the storm clouds of doubt and fear threaten to overcome us,
God leads us into ways of peace.
When the darkness of war and the deep pit of anger reach toward us,
God lifts and carries us through the darkness with hope and light.
Lord of hope and life, be with us today.
God of mercy and peace, lead our lives. Amen.
Please join me in the opening prayer. When we feel overwhelmed by the storms of life, enter our hearts with your redeeming love, O Christ. When our fears overtake us and we cannot find our way, give us direction that we might faithfully serve you all our days, singing your praises. Amen.
No matter what befalls us, the Lord walks with us on the path, bringing us courage and hope. No matter what, we belong to the Lord, now and forever. Amen. Over the past week, as you know, we've been setting aside a few moments each week during our time of worship to learn more about our Bibles from the Bible Project folks. And this week, we learn what the Bible means by the word transgression. Let's watch.
Most people assume the Bible has a lot to say about how messed up humans are, and that's true. It's also true that the Bible's vocabulary about this topic sounds odd to modern people, using words like sin, iniquity, or transgression. And so the Bible's perspective on the human condition is often ignored or treated as ancient and backwards. This is really unfortunate, because through these words, the biblical authors are offering us a deeply profound diagnosis of human nature. Iniquity refers to behavior that's crooked, while sin refers to moral failure. And transgression, this is a fascinating word that you for sure haven't used in conversation recently. So let's focus on it for a few minutes. In Old Testament Hebrew, the noun is pesha, and the verb is pasha. In the New Testament, the Greek word is paraptoma. They're usually translated as transgression, sometimes as rebellion, and in older translations as trespass. These words refer to ways that people violate the trust of others. Pesha describes the betrayal of a relationship, and since there are many kinds of relationships, a lot of different behaviors can be called pesha. Like, if two nations are in a relationship, we would call that a treaty. And pesha would describe the breaking of that agreement. Like in the biblical book of 2 Kings, we read, "After the death of King Ahab, Moab peshed with Israel." Now, this is usually translated, "Moab rebelled against Israel." But in biblical Hebrew, you don't pesha against someone, you pesha with them. That is, you break trust with that person. The same idea appears in an Old Testament law about theft. If an Israelite is away on a trip and somebody sneaks into their house and steals something, that's robbery. But if the thief was your neighbor, it's pesha, because there's someone you should be able to trust. Or there's a story about Jacob running away from Laban, his uncle. Laban accuses Jacob of stealing some idol statues. He searches all of Jacob's belongings, and he finds nothing. So Jacob shouts, "What is my pesha? How have I violated your trust?" But the sad irony is that the statues were stolen by Jacob's wife, who is Laban's own daughter. Talk about breaking trust. So pesha involves one person or group violating a relationship of trust with another. And this is a really common word in the Bible because it's one long story about a broken relationship between God and the Israelites. At Mount Sinai, they agreed to worship only their God and to care for the poor among them, but they didn't. And so God raised up prophets to confront them, like Micah, who said, "I'm full of power, with the Spirit of the Lord and with justice and courage, so I can declare to Jacob his pesha." Or the prophet Amos, he accused the Israelites of pesha, specifically for idolatry and selling the poor for a pair of sandals. He also accused other nations, like Tyre, who profited from capturing whole towns and then selling them into slavery. Or the Ammonites for murdering the innocent to enlarge their borders. For Amos, these are all acts of pesha. They violate the universal trust that exists between all humans who are made in the image of God. He watched these leaders ignore or justify the mistreatment of humans in the name of national security or a strong economy. But for Amos, it was a betrayal of humanity. And it makes perfect sense why these prophets associate pesha with words like treachery or falsehood. In the Greek New Testament, the Apostle Paul develops this portrait of humans as trust breakers, using the word paraptoma. He recalls the story in Genesis about Adam, that means humanity in Hebrew. And in that story, humanity breaks trust with God and seizes authority to discern good and evil on their own terms. Paul calls this the paraptoma of Adam, humanity's violation of trust with God and with each other. And it leads to a complicated web of betrayed and broken relationships leading towards violence and death. But for Paul, that is not the last word. He says, "If death came to all by the paraptoma of a human, how much more will God's gracious gift overflow to many by means of a human, Jesus the Messiah?" Instead of letting humanity destroy itself in treachery, God raised up a human who would allow our pesha to do its worst to him. Here Paul is drawing on the prophet Isaiah's portrait of the suffering servant, the one who would commit no violence or have any treachery on his lips, yet he would be counted among those in Peshah, bearing their failures and interceding on their behalf. And this is the surprising story of the Bible, that God's response to humanity's Peshah and Parabdoma was to be trustworthy on our behalf. The apostles claim that in Jesus, God took responsibility for our betrayal so that he could open up a new future and a new way to be human, the way of faithfulness, trustworthiness, and integrity. That's the kind of human that Jesus was and is, and it's the kind of humans he wants to create as he faithfully guides our world into the new creation. And that's the fascinating story behind our biblical words for transgression.
Listen as the Spirit speaks to her church from Psalms for Praying, Psalm 114. Come, all you who have wandered far from the path, who have separated yourselves from love, a banquet is prepared for you in the heart's secret room. There you will find the way home, a welcome ever awaits you. Even as you acknowledge the times you have erred, the forgiveness of the beloved will envelop you. Call upon the beloved when fear arises, when you feel overwhelmed. The eternal listener will heed your cry. You will find strength to face the shadows. Befriend all that is within you. Discover the secret room in your heart. Then will abundant blessings enter your home, and you will welcome the divine guest who is ever with you. May God bless the reading and hearing of the word.
Our second lesson comes from the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, chapter 14, verses 19 through 31. And this is a tale where God is intervening when man has transgression against one another. Let's listen now to the word for God's people. The angel of God, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them. And a pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night, and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of the Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn, the sea returned to its normal depth. As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers and the entire army of the Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea. not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and their left. Thus, the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians, so the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. This is the word for God's people. May God bless all who keep it, who hear it, and who share it. Let's pray. Open our ears, O Lord, to hear your word and embed them in our hearts to do your will. Amen. So this Bible scene is the drama in which stuff of Hollywood special effects are made, isn't it? Like we saw this morning, the story is miraculous and violent. It's victorious and also deadly. It's the final act of liberation for the Israelites, the Pharaoh's army, and therefore the Pharaoh himself, finally, once and for all, is defeated. Many of you remember the 1956 movie that I showed in our countdown this morning, The Ten Commandments. I remember they used to run it, at least in my hometown, each year around Easter time. Do you remember the scenes of the Israelites leave Egypt, Joshua riding on a horse and gathering the people to get them ready? The movie had such vivid technicolors and textures. In the film, as the Israelites are leaving the pyramids behind them, they don't get far until they encounter the sea in front of them and Pharaoh's army quickly coming behind. They fled the slavery of Egypt, and now they find themselves trapped by a watery chaos that blocks the way forward, and a vengeful army of violent chaos closing in close behind them. In the film, the confusion and fear are apparent. There are animals running around, and women and babies crying, and men planning mutiny against Moses. And you can also see the dark cloud of God beginning to form on the horizon. As Yul Brynner, the Pharaoh, gets closer, a pillar of fire appears, blocking the Egyptian army from advancing. The music soars as Moses stands on a rock overlooking the water and claims in a mighty voice, "The Lord of hosts will do battle for us." Then he turns to face the wind and he raises his staff and spreads his arms as the dark clouds plunges into the sea and the water is divided in half to form dry middle ground. That's vintage filmmaking at its very best. Well, scholar H.L. Ellison comments this. He says, one of the reasons why so many do not take this entirely credible story seriously is the pictures they saw in Sunday school, showing a wall of water standing up on either side of the Israelites as though they were held up by sheets of glass. It's a story of our long ago Sunday school lessons and vacation Bible school themes. It's the story told at tables of Jewish families at Shabbat. This is Exodus, a way out, which is exactly what the word Exodus means. Here at first glance, however, the water is a barrier to the Israelites' freedom. It's barring their way. It's an impassable obstacle of uncertainty and hopelessness. How can the Exodus continue, they wonder? How can the people reach a land of milk and honey, a land of freedom and abundance? A land where parents are no longer slaves and children are not plagued to be thrown into the waters of the Nile. Hemmed in and panicked, I imagine, these newly freed people of God find themselves trapped by dangerous waters in front and dangerous chariots behind. The way out is hidden from them. It's not clear. Either way, seems like it's going to cause their death. I know we've all been there at times, though, haven't we? In places where it just seems like there's no way out. A time just when things seemed on an uptick only to fall, to plummet into the depths. A job loss, and we think, where's the way out now? Or a failed marriage, and we think, what's the way out? Death of a beloved family member, cancer, illness, stroke. Where's the way out? Pandemic. And we wonder, where is our way out, oh God? And a broken system that for hundreds of years has prioritized one race over another. And many think, where is the way out? It is in verses just prior to the ones in our reading where we hear Moses tell his people, have no fear, stand by and witness the deliverance which the Lord will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will battle for you, he says. Hold your peace. And that is the power of this story. It's hard to believe imagery. Witness the delivery which the Lord will work for you today. In other words, the Lord will provide the way out. You know, our brothers and sisters in the African American church resonate deeply with this promise of the Lord providing a way out. As with the examples I just gave, we usually focus, though, on the individual aspects of God's deliverance. But this story reminds us that it's primarily about an entire people, God's people, a people enslaved and oppressed. Spirituals that a lot of us know retold the story of the Exodus saga as a way to give those slaves hope. And the song and the story itself became the way out. Spirituals like the one we heard in our prelude, if you were on early enough, that goes like this, oh Mary, don't you weep no more. Oh Mary, don't you weep, don't you mourn. Pharaoh's army got drowned. Oh Mary, don't you weep. This song predates the Civil War and was called a slave song for its message of hope and liberation. The song is sung to Mary of Bethany, who grieves deeply over her brother Lazarus' death. The song reminds Mary of her own tradition's central story, the Exodus, that when there seems like there's no way out, the Lord provides a way. Mary, don't you weep over Lazarus' death. Remember, God will provide a way out. Enslaved people of God, don't weep and mourn because the Lord will provide a way. For African slaves, this song and others like it, along with the Exodus stories, provided the hope they needed for a promised liberation, a way out in the midst of bondage, a way out when it seemed like there was no way. Presbyterian pastor Albert Wynn says this, the story of the Red Sea is about a people, a nation of slaves, who had no way. It is, he says, to use a nasty church word, a nasty word in church, a political story, he says. Political because when those in charge use the poor and disadvantaged for gain. Political because when those at the bottom are used at the disposal of those at the top, it shows how sinful political systems can be. And Wynn goes on to say that the Black community is connected with this Exodus story so closely because, he writes, we all need to understand that God is on the side of the stateless ones, the homeless ones, the unarmed ones, the powerless, the marginalized, and the oppressed. They told us in seminary that God's justice is not always what we think of as equity, but it tilts toward the poor. And I have to admit that as a white, educated, middle-class woman with certain privileges, I struggle to hear that message. I don't know about you, but sometimes it's hard to hear. Because this whole liberation message doesn't describe my situation. And when preached a sermon at Central Presbyterian Church in Atlanta, and the church sits right across the street from Georgia's Capitol building. And with humility and boldness, when asked the mostly white congregation, can it be that we white Americans know somewhere deep down in our subconscious minds that we're more like the Egyptians than the Israelites? I don't know what to do with that, other than, like Mary, to weep, to grieve, to feel ashamed and sometimes defensive, and suddenly to feel like asking the question, how then can there be a way out? Are we hemmed in? Chaos behind and chaos in front? Sometimes it sure seems that way. Are we wedged between a history of shame and a future of guilt? Chimamanda Adichie is a Nigerian author, and she was featured in a TED Talk entitled The Danger of a Single Story. And in her TED Talk, she explained that when we have a single view of anyone, we lose the ability to truly see them and honor the complex story they bring. We lose the ability to let them be a complex and complicated people. For me, and maybe for most of us, this story of the Red Sea has been one of those single stories about the triumph of God. The story was about saving Israel, which in a way I saw myself part of, because after all, I'm a Christian and our heritage comes right through those Old Testament stories. But the danger of the single story was for me to hear only the rejoicing of Egypt. As the walls of water retreat back to the normal in the Red Sea, Miriam, in the coming verses, Moses' sister, sang this song. She sings, "Sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and driver he hurled into the sea." And I've been singing with Miriam all this time, with Israel, with the oppressed, even as I sit here 2,000 years later, faithful, yet privileged, more Egyptian than Israelite. You see, any government or people who take power for themselves and leave the poor orphaned or out are guilty, and history is full of those examples. So we ask, is there a way out? Well, my Jewish Study Bible offers some of those side notes on this passage that I think can help us move from the danger of our well-known single story into the much larger and complex story of a loving and merciful God. According to the Study Bible notes, within a midrash interpretation, there were angels that sought to sing a hymn praising God as the Egyptians were drowning. But then God rebuked them, saying, "While my creatures are drowning in the sea, would you sing a hymn?" And so suddenly we see a God who frees the oppressed, yet weeps over the death of the oppressor. So as we look not for an antidote to make us feel better, but deeper into the complexity of the God we worship, we're reminded how this Exodus event has influenced our ritual of baptism. In Christian baptism, we claim that we go into those baptismal waters to die like Christ, to die to our old selves, to die to those former oppressive agendas that we once held, like the Egyptians. We die in those waters, but we come out of the waters into new life, a life that mirrors Christ's own life, new life that in the power and guidance of the Holy Spirit would have us follow the will of God so that all God's people would flourish and have life in abundance right here and right now with us. Our scripture tells the complex story of our God. And the more we read it, the more we tell it, the more we sing it, and the more the story is alive in us, the more complex and beautiful it becomes. We worship a God whose heart belongs to the forgotten, the lonely, the suffering, and the marginalized, but also a God whose heart extends to the powerful, the privileged, the influential, and the advantaged by the grace and power of Jesus Christ. Now I think I understand why the story of the parting of the Red Sea is such a prominent place in our history, because this story is just a piece of the complexity of all of our stories, but this story is also a witness that when it seems that there's no way out, God in Christ, through the Holy Spirit, always provides that way out for all of us. And all God's children said, Amen.
In gratitude for all the abundant blessings you have upon us, we celebrate as we receive our morning offering. Amen. Please remember the church by sending your offering to the church or using the link on our Facebook page.
Join me in a time of prayer. Loving and merciful God, we come before you this day fresh from a week in which we've been challenged. Some of the challenges have caused us to worry and strife, and others challenges bring to us clear directions for our lives. But in all of this, you are with us, bringing us healing and peace. This morning we offer to you the names of those who are ill, who mourn, who feel lost and alienated, wondering if anyone cares about them. We especially lift up
Jean Tanner family, Mia, Miriam Daniels.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Bud Warren, Jeanette and Ed, and Lauren Forbit.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
And all the residents of the West Coast fires and the firefighters.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And hear our prayers, O Lord, to bring your healing mercies to all those we have named with our hearts and our voices. And we also bring to you, loving God, names and situations of great joy and celebration. For you have been in our midst during these times as well as during the difficult times. We lift up successful school days and beginning of the football season, healing accomplished, birthday celebrations, and anniversaries. Hear our praises, O God. Bring your loving presence to all these people we have named with our hearts and voices, for it is in confidence that your abiding love and mercy that we offer this prayer, asking in the name of the one you sent to love and heal us, our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debtors as we forgive those who debt against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Sometimes my Methodist background just seeps right into that Lord's Prayer still. I hope you'll join me in our closing hymn, Lead On, O King Eternal. And now let us go in peace into God's world to serve and help others. Go in confidence of God's presence with you. And go into this world with messages of hope.